Welcome to our forum on the Nobel Prize, the 2015 Nobel Prize. This meeting has its origins 20 years ago when we wanted to give a little forum primarily for the students to describe what's so great about this Nobel Prize winning research. So you might think of this as the Nobel Prize made simple. So there will be four speakers, and the first speaker is from the Department of Physics, who will be describing the 2015 Nobel Prize in Physics. This is Professor Adrian Del Maestro, my esteemed colleague for the past 5 years. He's come to us by way of Harvard, where he received his PhD in physics, a postdoc at Johns Hopkins, and he is a theoretical physicist, low temperature physics primarily. His expertise is in superfluidity, low dimensions and so on, not neutrino physics. Oftentimes, with an institution of the size of UVM, it's not always the case that the research can be covered by someone whose actual research is in that area. So this year is one of those examples. Here on campus, but we don't have anyone who's involved in the experiments that Professor Del Maestro described. But as a theoretical physicist and one who is particularly versatile, he will give us some insight into the 2015 Nobel Prize. So I introduce to you Professor Del Maestro.
Solves a long-standing problem. Basically, the two recipients, Dr. Kijita and Art McDonald, one from Japan and one from Canada, are group leaders. So the total number of people involved in this prize is about 1,700 people. And these are the group leaders for those 1,700 people. So lots of hard work. And it's also kind of a nice prize because it's really two pieces. So one is the experimental observation, which is the discovery of neutrino oscillations, and I'll explain that to you. And then what it means. And basically, the discovery, the fact that neutrinos oscillate or change their flavor, means that neutrinos, at least two of the three, anyways, that we know that must have mass. So it's kind of a nice observation that has these broad implications. And it starts with basically the scariest thing you can imagine, a radioactive poltergeist. So in the 1930s, people were really worried. They were worried because they were studying radioactive decay. There's a very famous radioactive decay, actually. This is people have probably heard of carbon dating before, so this is what leads to carbon dating. So if I have a carbon-14 atom, which is an unstable form of carbon, it has 6 protons and 8 neutrons, one of those neutrons can basically decay into a proton plus an electron. So this process was known, and that produces a very stable isotope, negative-14, with 7 protons and 7 neutrons. So this is all fine and good, and the theory of this is where theory, this is essentially introductory physics. You have one atom that decays into two things. We can solve conservation of energy, conservation of momentum. And when we do that, you can get a prediction of the number of electrons versus the energy of this carbon-14 atom. There should have been a very big peak right here. And basically what was observed was the complete opposite of that peak. So people were worried. And so one of the possibilities, one of the way out of this, the fact that there's this continuous spectrum of the number of electrons coming out, it's a continuous function of the energy, is that this is not a two-body decay, but in fact it's a three-body decay. So in addition, there must be some new particle. We know that new particle must be neutral just because of charge conservation. It has to be extremely light because and weak in interacting because no one had ever measured it before. And so Wolfgang Pauli famously said, I've done a terrible thing. I've postulated this particle, so he solved this problem, that will never be detected. It can't be detected because it has no charge, so it doesn't interact with electromagnetic fields. And it's extremely light. It's very light, extremely light. And so this was the radioactive poltergeist, this ghost of a particle that no one would ever be able to find. But actually, in 1956, 2 years before Pauli died, he received this telegram in Zurich. We're happy to inform you that we've definitely detected neutrinos and fission fragments that were observing deeper state in the day of protons. Stop. So their cross-section agrees well with expected 6 times 10 minus 44 square centimeters. Stop. I guess they didn't have the exact number of these telegrams. And so this was sent by Frederick Rains and Claude Cohen. And so 2 years before Pauli's death, these neutrinos were discovered. And they were discovered basically in the 50s. There's all these nuclear reactors that were being built in the US. and those nuclear reactors were producing all kinds of neutrinos. And so Raines and Cohen unfortunately passed away before they received the Nobel Prize for this in 1995, built a detector inside a nuclear reactor in Georgia, and they were able to discover neutrinos that were interacting with the protons in their detector, and the number of them agreed pretty well in cross-section with what all they had in their concept. So this kind of work, these neutrinos were real particles that weren't poltergeists anymore. But we have these reactors, but actually the biggest source of neutrinos that's anywhere nearby to us is the sun. The sun produces a gigantic number of neutrinos. So basically thousands of billions of neutrinos coming from the sun are passing through this room right now. And we have very good models for how the inside of the sun works, how we produce energy inside the sun. And so we're able to count how many neutrinos should come out of the sun. And this disparity of the number of neutrinos predicted versus that we observe is what led to this so-called neutrino problem. So basically, fusion in the sun works the following way. We take four protons, so hydrogen atoms, and for now we can produce a helium atom, two positrons, which just a positively charged electron, and then some number of two neutrinos. Right? So based on everything we know about the sun and the energy coming out, we can predict how many neutrinos, electron neutrinos, we should see on Earth. And so this is the expected number right here. And Raymond Davis Jr. built a large detector, essentially a gigantic tank full of dry cleaning solution, and he observed only one-third. So this is a pretty serious problem in physics, right? If you only get things one-third correct, you probably made a pretty serious mistake. So this led to this so-called solar neutrino problem. So where are these other two-thirds of the neutrinos? And it's especially important because we know a lot about particle physics. We know a lot about the fundamental particles that make up the universe. This is why we call the model of particles the standard model. Right? It's something so well accepted, we can call it standardized. So basically all the particles that we know about, we have particles called quarks. These make up things like protons, hadrons. We have leptons, and we have Higgs bosons, which basically carry forces, and people have probably heard about the Higgs boson recently. But so far I've talked about electron neutrinos. Those are the types of neutrinos that are produced in the sun. But they correspond to the associated neutrinos with electrons. But there's other leptons that have different types of neutrinos. So there's three different flavors of neutrinos. And in 1998, these guys, Letterman, Schwartz, and Steinberger, got the Nobel Prize for basically figuring out how to see the muon neutrino. So there's three types of neutrinos that are known there. The sun produces only electron neutrinos. So people had a sort of transformational idea that maybe neutrinos can change their flavor. They can oscillate between different flavors as they travel from the sun to the Earth. And so if they could do that, if they could change their flavor, because the detectors were only sensitive to one type of neutrino, the electron neutrino, if the neutrinos that started as electron neutrinos and then changed, well, they might have turned into tau or muon neutrinos. So how do we test that idea? And testing and proving that idea is what got the Nobel Prize this year. So the first part was the so-called Super Kamioka NDE experiment, where NDE stands here for neutrino detection experiment. So I told you that neutrinos are incredibly weakly interacting. They're really hard to detect. And so these big experiments tend to be in mines, kilometers below the surface of the Earth. So this one's in Kamioka, Japan. It's a kilometer down. It's basically a big tank of water, 40 meters high, surrounded by cameras. And this particular experiment was only sensitive to muon neutrinos, so only one type of neutrinos. And what did they observe? So they know that these muon neutrinos come from the atmosphere, come from cosmic rays interacting with the atmosphere. And because of the fact that this thing is really a big camera, they can tell which direction the neutrino came from. And so when they did this experiment, what they found is that they measured the amount of neutrinos predicted by theory coming from just right above, so only up here, 1 kilometer in the atmosphere above. But when they looked at neutrinos coming all the way from the other side of the Earth that had to go all the way through the Earth, they didn't detect enough of those. Right? So there weren't enough muon neutrinos coming all the way through the Earth. The ones produced close by, they measured exactly the number that they expected. And so this was the first piece of evidence that, while being only sensitive to muon neutrinos, these ones maybe had to travel farther. They had to travel all the way through the Earth, so they had more time to change their flavor, to turn into a different flavor. But this experiment was only sensitive to muon neutrinos. The experiment was done in 98. This is a picture of the inside of the tank. Some guys on a boat, you can just get a feeling for how huge and how expensive these things are. Each of these is one of those cameras I told you. This thing would be filled with water, the neutrino comes in, creates Cherenkov radiation, and you can see the direction taken. Okay, so this is only muon neutrinos. So the final piece of the puzzle came in 2001. This is Art McDonald's team. It's the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory in old nickel mine, 2 kilometers below the surface of the Earth. And so instead of using just water in this snow experiment, they used heavy water. So water that has extra neutrons. And that meant the following things. So one, it meant that they were sensitive not to muon neutrinos, like the super Kamiokande experiment. They were sensitive to electron neutrinos. And they could count exactly how many electron neutrinos they had. And they counted, indeed, one-third the number that was expected from the models. So this agreed with the previous experiments. But they were also sensitive to all types of neutrinos combined. So they couldn't figure out which one they were, but they knew that all of the neutrinos were producing some type of reactions. And so they measured one-third the number of electron neutrinos, but when they added up all of the neutrinos that they saw, they went up to exactly the right number. So this was the final piece of the puzzle that indeed neutrinos could change on their way from the sun to the Earth. This is a picture of this gigantic ball filled with heavy water inside of it, 2 kilometers below the Earth. Okay, so this basically means that neutrinos mix. They oscillate between different flavors. So how do we understand that? So technically, basically it means that the neutrinos that we observe, the electron, muon, and tau neutrino, aren't mass eigenstates. Okay, so what does that mean? So basically, we all know about additive color mixing, right? How we create all colors from the primary colors. So I think this is a nice way to think about this. So in my slide color scheme, I chose this to be my red, this to be my green, and this to be my blue. So I think they're a little bit more pleasing. Here's pure red, pure green, and pure blue, right? So basically, I have some states. These are the mass eigenstates. These are the real physical neutrinos. But all we can observe on Earth is these mixed states, where these A, B, C are just some numbers. So if we think about that in terms of colors, this red right here is 50% red, 25% green, and 88%. This muon neutrino, 95, 27, 38, and this tau neutrino, 25, 93, and 81. So basically the way to think about this is on Earth, we can't measure this nu1, nu2, nu3, but instead what we can measure are these electron, muon, and tau neutrinos that are just made up of these ones, just like additive colors. And as these neutrinos propagate through space, the amount of these individual colors mix. They change in time. They actually oscillate in time. And so on Earth, that's why we basically see them change into the different flavors. All right, so that's the oscillation. What does this mean about mass? So we can actually predict what's the probability of one type of neutrino changing into another type of neutrino. And that depends on the length, the distance that the neutrino travels, but it also depends on the difference in mass between. So the existence of the observed oscillation means that this delta m, the difference in mass, has to be non-zero. And the difference in mass can only be non-zero if at least two of the three masses are non-zero. So that's the whole piece. So we've already had 4 Nobel Prizes. I'll just kind of flash this up there. I would say there's probably still 2 more Nobel Prizes in here, if you want to go into neutrino physics. So the actual masses aren't known, only these difference in masses. We don't even know why they're so lightweight. They're these tiny little particles, we have no idea. All kinds of questions. So I'll answer your questions right now. I have a demo. So I have a box here. It has 1,000 billion neutrinos inside of it. There you go. So the energies of neutrinos depend on all kinds of things, but indeed, because the masses are in principle different, because those delta m's are zero, they have slightly different energies as well.
Okay, but could you give a ballpark energy compared to microwave energies or something?
Sure. So I can give you. So they're extremely small, they're extremely light. So the masses or the energies are actually shown up here in the corner of this. So an electron is a pretty small thing, and so it's 0.5 mega-eV, and we don't know the actual masses, but we have bounds on them, and they're at least thousands of times or even hundreds of thousands of times lighter than electrons. So the energies are low, but they travel very fast. They travel almost at the speed of light. Yeah, that's an excellent question. So as far as we understand the mechanics of fusion across all suns, all types of suns produce electron neutrinos. Tau neutrinos come from cosmic rays, and muon neutrinos as well, interactions with the atmosphere. atmosphere. So there could be other types of neutrinos out there that we haven't been able to measure yet. But the ones that we do know how to measure, there's three of them that we've been able to observe. And yeah, so but any sun would produce electron neutrinos. Yep.
Speaking about the heavy water tank, is there a significance why they chose to use the deuterium ion or atoms in
yeah.
there? And also, how did they get such a large quantity of them?
Also a great question. So basically, the details of how the detections occur are related to processes that happen when a neutrino bumps into a neutron or bumps into a proton. And so the heavy water means there's more neutrons per unit volume, and so that enhances the ability to have these interactions. So actually, how they measure them is via Cherenkov radiation. This is really cool. I had a so Cherenkov radiation. So Cherenkov radiation is basically just like a sonic boom. So when these neutrinos come in and they hit one of these neutrons, it basically produces a sonic boom made out of light. And so you see this big cone of light come out, and that's what's observed by the cameras. And so by having more neutrons in, they're able to see more of these events. And they're sensitive to all three different types of neutrinos. The heavy water thing, so Canada used to have a very large theoretical research, nuclear research institute. And they produced a lot of heavy water, which they were able to prevent and move down the separator. All right, thank you very much.
Crazy when we use general functional form as opposed to a specific functional form. the reason that we do that is not to torture the poor souls, but it's because we just don't know what the functional forms are. That's our biggest problem. Here he tells us about convexity, tells us about monotonicity, continuity, sometimes differentiability, sometimes, but the problem is it leaves off there. So we really don't know whether the function looks like that or like that most of the time. Now that causes a problem in economics. To be able to say anything, we therefore have to impose a large amount of structure on any empirical problem that we address. And that leaves a small voice, if you will, for the data. So what Angus Deaton did was originally look at the problem of the combination of structure and data and say, look, we've got to stop emphasizing structure and emphasize data more. One of his most important contributions that really has real-world implications is the fact that so many of the demand functions that have been used up until the time, and there have been some Nobel Prize awarded people that came up with these demand functions. So these are not trivial contributions whatsoever. But the main point is that these functions did not recognize substitution. That is, when prices rise, and especially poor people, they tend to substitute cheaper alternatives. Therefore, said Deaton, poverty is overstated. To soak that up for a second, that's quite an important contribution he's making right there in that sentence. People are actually not as poor as we think because of substitution. Next time you feel like dissing Walmart, okay, because it causes poverty, you're going to get into an argument with Angus Deaton, who says Walmart allows people to substitute into cheaper sources of utility for themselves, and therefore actually reduces poverty more than it contributes to it. So, another example of this system as it's been used is to assess the damage in antitrust suits. If a firm has raised prices in an illegitimate way, think Microsoft, everyone went after them, how much damage would that have caused people? Well, you can look at the counterfactual in silico, that is in the computer. And this is the main thing that economists are using these models for, because it's a lot easier and it's a lot more humane than going out and trying to experiment on actual people. Although that has been done by the University of Chicago in South America in the past, it's not something we like to talk about. So a cable company raises its price by $10 due to its monopoly power. The Justice Department said, wait a second. It hits the company with a lawsuit for damages. What's the damage here? N times $10, we would think. That's the first order approximation. In fact, what Deaton's models show is that people will substitute away. If there are substitutes for cable, like the internet, for example, then the damage is not $10 times the number of people who have purchased the service. It becomes an empirical problem that can be estimated through the almost ideal demand system. Deaton also takes a pretty strong position on foreign aid. He has just written a very influential book on foreign aid, and basically he's a fairly optimistic individual on the ability of humans to escape poverty, which is, of course, right now we're at a point in human history where things have never been better in terms of average incomes, and more people, a million people a month, are escaping poverty now. So we're looking at a time that is an acceleration in the so-called Great Escape. That's the title of this book, From Poverty. He doesn't think that foreign aid is going to play an important role, or has played an important role. He says that it's really about us. The quotation there is from Angus Deaton. It's a little chilling. He finds this very troubling, that if foreign aid were actually going to be damaged to the country, we would stop foreign aid. The reason, of course, is that if we give foreign aid to governments, especially governments that have a significant share of their foreign aid, or their budgets coming from foreign sources, that denies the legitimacy by undermining the agency of their own citizens, responsible for their own citizens. Now, the thing that I like about Deaton, as I'm active in UVM's complex systems group here, is that a lot of what he looks at, and what a lot of his claims are based on, evaluating well-being from the perspective of the agents of the economy. Some economists don't do that. Some economists would prefer that the economy behave the way they would prefer. But Angus Deaton is among the group of economists, a growing group, now a majority, I would say, that evaluates human welfare from the point of view of what the humans themselves think about their own situation. In other words, if an agent thinks she is better off, then the agent is better off, and that confers a scientific tenet in economics that when we were looking at the economy from the outside observer's point of view, wishing that we behave more to our life, we did not have. Deaton says that people should respect the agencies of agency of individuals in developing countries. And when we don't factor in the goals that they themselves have, we're making a mistake. The vocation here, agencies being denied, they're not being treated as human beings. Foreign assistance comes in and helps repress the government rather than the people they're supposed to help. Now, not all aid is bad. He takes a nuanced position. There are many cases. Here's an interesting thought experiment. Consider all foreign aid that has ever been given to a poor country by a rich country. Just sum it up in your mind. You'll get a number somewhere between 1 and 5 trillion. That's a pretty big range, but let's just go with that. Assume that no foreign aid program ever did any good. In other words, the costs were there, but the benefits were zero. Except for one, and that's the one that solved the problem of smallpox, that saved 60 to 120 million lives. More people were saved than that than would have been saved in the 20th century by world peace during that century. The cost, even if you factor in all the other aid projects and pile them on to the cost of that smallpox project, would have given you $70,000 per human life saved. That's 1/100 of what the U.S. government uses as the value of a human life, the statistical value of a human life, about $78 million. Deaton is widely regarded. The most interesting thing that I have learned in preparing this talk for you tonight is that both the left and the right love him. People as far on the left as Krugman, the New York Times, to people that Peter Betke, George Wilson, praise him as a triumph of evidence-based economics. We used to think, since Paul Samuelson in the 1940s won a Nobel Prize for putting economics on a much more mathematical basis, claiming that before 1940, two economists could be arguing about this, about a proposition and be on the same side of it and not realize that because they had put their arguments into mathematical form. Since then, we have considered economics a branch of applied mathematics. The prize validates a new view of economics as a branch of computer or data science. It's a feather in the cap. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Very non-ideological individual in that regard.
looking at the data and seeing the data. For example, the most recent contribution he's made is to look at the death rates. This came out after the Great Escape. The death rates of middle-aged white non-Latino males that had only a high school education has actually been increasing in the last few years. That doesn't happen around the world. It doesn't even happen in developing countries. Why are they dying at higher rates? Because of alcohol abuse and because of drug abuse and finally suicide. So this is not a good thing.
Building on that, when you talk about encapsulating his theory of agency and asking people whether or not they're happy, how do you account for delusion, as it were? Like, we give a bunch of people opium and they're all happy because they're stoned, but they're not actually in a good place.
Well, you can talk to people at Caltech who work on rational theories of addiction, and they will tell you that there's no objective scientific way that I can tell the person who claims is happy that he's not happy. There's just no way to do that. If there were, if we had a legitimate outside observer, they could come in and say, no, I can go inside your mind, I can tell that you're really not happy. That would be wonderful. We just don't have that in economics. Now what we do have is revealed preference. You may believe that person is not happy. You may, in your heart, and you may even know, in some sense, people that are not deriving utility. But let me just say a couple things. That is a very difficult scientific proposition to demonstrate. And number two, that if we had a measure of happiness in economics, the field would change completely because we never use the word. We don't ever use that word. Now imagine a guy who comes out from a courtroom and he's just gotten a divorce and he has a heart attack on the steps of the courtroom building. Okay? He's paying a lot to an expensive lawyer. He's going to pay a lot to an expensive cardiac surgeon. He's just contributed more in those few minutes to GDP than just about anybody else in the country. And you ask the guy, are you happy? And he's going to say, absolutely not, I'm not happy. So we don't really use the term happiness. We use the term utility. Is there these people have well-being? Now, if they continue to make mistakes over and over and over, well, you have to argue that these people are not learning from their mistakes and not rational. If they end up at rehab, we would argue that they were rational. But if they don't, then you have to argue that they're just not following our rational model. And if there's enough people that are doing that, then economics is going to suffer. These models are not going to be accurate.
So he doesn't ask for happiness, no. But he also doesn't ask for measures of life productivity and lifespan.
Well, actually, he has gotten involved with happiness, with some happiness literature. So if we're talking about Angus Deaton, winner of the Nobel Prize, yeah, he has done that. But it's considered to be a swamp by most economists. It's not an easy area to get into because of its indefinite, indefinite character. See, the thing is that when we look at ordinary trades, you go into to Walmart or any other store, and a person puts down $15 and buys something with that $15. From a scientific point of view, we have evidence that their preference function, okay, we have evidence about their preference function. There's nobody that's ever gone into a store and said, I'm buying this, but I don't really want it. I'm just doing it to trick the economists. So we take that as hard evidence. We take what people actually do, not what they say. Cheap talk in economics is a big concept. If you claim that you want to support the environment, but you don't actually give up money to support the environment, well then that is called cheap talk. In order to want something, for example, one of the leading textbooks starts off with the economist that teaches in Middlebury, says, I love Lamborghinis, but I can't really say that I do because I don't have one. I'm not willing to do the things. I'm not willing to give up all of what I would need to give up to obtain a Lamborghini. I'm perfectly happy teaching in Middlebury, he says. So you can't say that you love a Lamborghini is cheap talk. If you have a Lamborghini, you put the money down and bought one. So we have to use evidence. You see, I hear what you're saying. You look at these drug-addicted people. He looks at the people that are dying at elevated rates and says, this is a terrible thing. But it's not so far. Now, when fMRI data becomes much more available and much more reliable, perhaps when our students become professors and do research projects in the next 20, 30 years, that maybe we can come to a truly objective definition of utility. That would be a wonderful thing. But right now we don't have it, except for revealed preference. Revealed through the actual market transactions.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, let's thank Phil again. So I wanted to move on. I'm Chris Landry. I'm chair of the Department of Chemistry, and I'll be introducing the next two speakers. So next we have Chris Huston, who is coming from the Department of Medicine. He's also in the Department of Microbiology and Molecular Genetics. And he'll be presenting about the department or the Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology. And when I contacted Chris about this panel, he insisted on not preparing a presentation. Another presentation to him. So we'll do a different sort of format, maybe. I have definitely some questions that I would like to ask, and so I thought we would do more of a new format, maybe starting with Chris giving some background on the prize itself.
Yeah, that sounds fair. That I feel now horribly unprepared because actually those were two beautiful talks. So the Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology this year went for two different achievements in developing therapeutics for parasites. So, and the prizes, I guess, as a common theme, have direct relevance to public health and the impact of those developments. So one half of the prize was given to two scientists working distantly, they were working together. One, Satoshi Omura, who is a microbiologist in Japan, and another, William Campbell, who's working at Merck, and a parasitologist. And those two shared 50% prize for the development of a drug called ivermectin, which is the treatment for filarial diseases, so roundworm infections. Causes elephantiasis. And if I had prepared a talk, I would have some deck. If you type in elephantiasis in Google Images, right, it just really prevents the adult worms develop in the lymphatics, and clog up the lymphatics, and so they tremendously spoil things, collection fluid or scrotum, and it's very good. And ivermectin is a spectacular treatment. Maybe I'll just stick with the ivermectin thing for a while before talking about the other half of the prize. Satoshi Omura started out with a really, really simple idea that I guess in terms of antimicrobial development goes all the way back to Fleming, which is that microbes themselves produce antibiotics. In fact, most of the microbes, antimicrobials that we have roots in natural products And so Omura figured that if he could just figure out how to grow new microbes from dirt, and he was focused on Streptomyces species, that they may produce additional natural products that would be useful for medicine. And he figured out how to grow about 50 of these microbes. And Campbell was working at Merck, and as I said, he's an expert on roundworms. And had some assays that worked out that are simply basically looking at whether or not the worms can continue moving. So it's really simple phenotypic assays. He heard about Omura's extracts from these Streptomyces species, got them put them on, and lo and behold, one of the extracts produced a compound which they later identified as the ivermectin that paralyzes the lungs. Ivermectin works as an anti-helminth drug by blocking a glutamate-sensitive, glutamate-gated calcium channel that's expressed in muscle cells and nerve cells of many different roundworms or nematodes, and literally paralyzes the worms. And they, it's not entirely clear how they die, but most people think that they ultimately starve to death. So that's a drug that has had an absolutely enormous public health impact. When Campbell and Omura did their studies, they were really simple concepts of phenotypic assays that led to it, and knowledge of how that drug works is all after the fact, after the public health impact.
So Chris, maybe this would be a good time to just to ask a couple questions. So, you know, with the first two awardees who are in the Campbell for the ground. So one question maybe that I have noticed is, you know, the roundworms are causing these diseases like elephantiasis, but then, first of all, you know, what is leading to the disease? Like, what is the, you know, is it development of the roundworm in tissue, and then how does that lead specifically to those diseases? And then, ivermectin, for example, that is so specific. So how does it interfere with that part with the diseases?
Right. Well, I guess following up on the elephantiasis example, the life cycle of what's involved in that, famous one, I guess. The infection is acquired initially from mosquito bite. It's quite common in Southeast Asia. And the mosquito delivers a filarial form to the bloodstream form. And then that form ultimately develops into an adult in lymphatic lymph nodes. And the disease essentially is related to the mechanics of the lymphatics and the
blood things up. Tissue damage.
Yeah, the inflammation, plugging things up. You know, and it's a similar situation if someone has, say breast cancer, and they undergo a mastectomy and a removal of lymph nodes in their armpit, their axilla, they'll very often get a very swollen arm, and that predisposes them to then getting bacterial infections to that arm. It would be quite a problematic thing for someone to have that kind of surgery. And really, these worms plugging up the lymphatics and causing scarring in the lymphatic tissue there, plus the problem, essentially the same thing. In terms of the action of ivermectin, it's really only active against the filarial form of the parasite, which is it's a multicellular but microscopic form, the form that's engendered by the mosquito. And so, and people who get the clinical manifestations of these things typically are people who live in a place where they're getting bitten by mosquitoes over and over and acquire a whole bunch of initial filarial infections, and then time, luxury, so, you know, a typical person traveling to Southeast Asia who gets a mosquito bite is more at risk for something like malaria, where the parasite can replicate the developing elephantiasis.
Yes. And then maybe we'll move on to the last awardee, and then we'll have some questions.
Yeah, so the other person who shared 50% of the prize this year is a woman named a chemist, sort of an herbal medicinal chemist in China. Her paper that actually the Nobel Prize is based on is written in Chinese. I didn't read it. She basically in the 1960s, it was pretty clear that despite initial excitement about the possibility of eradicating malaria using chloroquine and quinine derivatives, in the early 1960s, it became pretty clear that was going to fail because of developing drug resistance. And she was aware of Chinese herbal approaches to treating malaria using extracts from, or actually using a plant called Artemisia. And she decided to try to figure out, A, if that actually works, and B, what's the active ingredient. And so she went back to sort of the ancient Chinese herbal medicine literature, figured out which plants to screen, test, and then she ultimately purified a compound called an artemisinin compound, which subsequently went on to become really the best treatment for severe malaria that's available. It ironically is not approved by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration. Right, there's no profit in it. So companies have to get bothered. And actually, a couple of years ago, one of my colleagues at the hospital applied for human research approval to be able to get, for us to be able to get emergent use artemisinin from the CDC if we needed it, because you can't use it except under experimental conditions in the United States. But it's been given to hundreds of millions of people as the best treatment for malaria in the world. Kills malaria parasites much more rapidly than the other drugs that are known, and the rate of parasite clearance is much more rapid. That's sort of the basis for its apparent special effects. And if you look at sort of the public health impacts, there's like 4 billion people at risk for malaria. It's carried by anopheles mosquitoes, and unlike the worms, one bite can inoculate one that then can initially enter your liver and it gets into red blood cells and replicate exponentially and cause the full clinical disease. So 4 billion people at risk, about 200 million cases annually, about a half a million deaths annually, most people are children, and the artemisinins have dramatically reduced that mortality. So that's what she got her price for.
So my one question there, like what happened before, is actually related to public health. You know, everything I read about really all, well, both diseases and all three of the diseases, was talking about you know, how these are diseases linked in some ways to poverty and to the third world and things like that. But is that just because those populations live in areas that are high risk, or is it, you know, what is their connection there?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I see a few people in the room here who I think probably can answer that question better than I can. But clearly, in this country, malaria used to be a problem. You can find many historical accounts of malaria as a problem in this country. Other tropical diseases or parasitic diseases, like one that I study, Entamoeba histolytica, you know, it was first discovered in Baltimore in the 1800s. The first clear descriptions of that. And so I think it clearly some of those diseases are related to hygiene, and to me that it is. Many of them are simply related to densities of the populations and to the abundance of the vectors, the insect vectors, basically. There are relatively simple interventions that can be done to reduce the incidence, such as using bed nets or just having screens in houses, and those things are inavailability. Those things obviously are so it's probably both sides are probably right.
Okay, so some questions from the audience, yeah.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could speak to, especially with the current field of this program, how people are usually treated, like, or how, like, how different is this new treatment from, like, the
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually. I don't honestly have a clue. I think ivermectin was developed in the 70s, so that, I think you said you started a faculty position in 1986. I was in high school in 1986, so ivermectin's been around since I've been familiar with this. And you see, you know, ancient pictures of or not so ancient pictures of people, you know, with a wheelbarrow to carry their scrotum. I mean, it's ridiculous. But I don't know of any prior treatments. Beth, do you know of treatments other than ivermectin that existed before?
They used
to be
seen for that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oxygen, because your cells are at 98.62 degrees, you accumulate 30 to 40,000 damages in each of your cells in your body every day. So this is tons. While you've been sitting here listening to these, each cell in your body has gotten 100 or more damages. So these are huge amounts of damages. So you can easily imagine that if you don't repair them, they lead to something. And we know that damages that are not repaired by basic incision repair lead to neurological diseases, lead to cancer, autoimmune diseases, lots of other things. Fortunately, this is a system I work on. I met Thomas Lindahl at the very first DNA repair meeting in 1974, where he was reporting the enzyme. He got the Nobel, and I was reporting a second one. So that's life in science. So it's a very important system, where, and it's very simple, and it's conserved from the simplest bacteria. And all these three of these prizes were given to people working in E. coli, Escherichia coli. It's the model organism for molecular biology for years and years and years and years. And the system is the same in bacteria and us. It was highly conserved across species. And so Thomas got the award for discovering an enzyme that removes uracil from DNA. And DNA has four bases in it. Uracil happens to be an RNA base, and sometimes it's converted into a DNA base, and the polymerase is incorporated by mistake. But more importantly, because we're at 98.6 degrees, another base in our DNA called cytosine just spontaneously deaminates, and it's not then paired correctly. So when the DNA divides, it doesn't pair with the base that it's supposed to pair. Remember, all of you from high school biology, that adenine always pairs with thymine, and cytosine always pairs with guanine. That's a very important thing. So when you make cytosine uracil, it doesn't pair with guanine. So Thomas, born in Sweden, and he's the first one to get a prize in chemistry since he's a very famous guy for years ago, which you heard the sales. Anyway. So they're pretty excited about that. Thomas was trained in Stockholm. He actually worked in Gothenburg for a number of years before going to Great Britain. But he did some postdoctoral work in the States. And then he went back to Sweden and then to Great Britain, where he worked for the cancer center over there. You have to retire in Great Britain. We're not the same age, but I had to retire. So I'm still having a good time in science. He's not. And I'm not going to do that. But he didn't even know the prize. It's very well deserved. The second system that the prize was given for was called mismatch repair. So let me just take a look forward here. So if you have your DNA molecule, remember, and they pair, right, it's a duplex molecule. And when it has to divide, when cells divide, there are enzymes called polymerases that come along, and they see this is an A, and they put a T, and they put an A, and a C, and they put a G. So they pair all the way along. Now, polymerases are very, very accurate, and they make one mistake in about 10 to 7 or so base pairs. We have several billion nucleotide pairs in our DNA. It turns out that they do make those mistakes, but this other repair system called mismatch repair comes in and repairs about 100 mistakes per 1 billion nucleotides incorporated. So this brings down your mistake level one in a billion. Okay, 3 billion. What does that mean? But if you have DNA replicating every 8 hours, this can be a real problem. You start to accumulate damages in the DNA. And it turns out that this particular system that Paul Modrich got the Nobel Prize for, he's at Duke University, he's a Howard Hughes scholar, he's a super, super, super nice man, very, very bright guy, trained in MIT and Stanford. Did all the biochemistry, again, using the E. coli proteins as the model systems initially, did all the beautiful biochemistry on this. It turns out that if you have defects in this mismatch repair system, type of colon cancer called a hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer, which you get because replication, if your cells replicate a lot, it's a mutagen. So if you were making one mistake in 10 to the 7th attempt instead of 10 to the 9th, base pairs, you start to accumulate damages, then you accumulate, especially in highly replicating cells like the colon cells, and you end up accumulating these damages that are not repaired or important oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes in cancer. And actually, that particular event, the colon cancer event, is actually discovered. Lots of press on that, then the NIH, etc. And that was really a result of this very, very basic science that all did beautiful, beautiful benefits. The third system, which is actually the first repair system really identified, is called nucleotide precision repair. And that prize was developed one by Oscillations. Did not discover it at all, but chemistry. So what is nucleotide precision repair? So nucleotide precision repair is a repair system that evolved to remove exogenous damages that come from the outside, the sunlight, that is the one that's been studied the most. Makes big, huge, bulky lesions in the smoking, prevents pyrene, not a good thing. Things from pesticides, herbicides, industrial waste, pollutants, anything that comes in and lesions on the DNA. So what you have now is your DNA molecule. You have some huge damage here. And that damage can't be repaired by a simple base incision repair. Say you measured that they repair these little damages, purely protein damages on strain breaks, etc. These are recognized by a series of proteins that actually end up first doing recognition, then they cut out of the piece of the DNA that has the damage. And put in new nucleotides. So if you are missing this repair system phenotype, the initial phenotype is unbelievable because you can't even be under a fluorescent light. That's how sensitive your cells are to damage. And what happens for individuals who have this can't repair these kinds of damages, the first thing they get, they use serum, it's called serodermic pigmentosum. Humans have seven different proteins that do all the initial steps of what I just showed you, the three proteins and bacteria. And if you're defective in any one of these, you get this disease. What happens is you get skin cancers. I would have shown you, actually. I have been told to. And you get horrible squamous basal cell melanomas, and people hardly ever live to their teenage years. It's just an awful disease. It's a rare homozygous recessive disorder. It's not very common. And an interesting story in the moment is that you take your kid to a pediatrician, right? The child is 6 months old, they come in bright red, and your mother gets yelled at for having the kid out in the sun. But I did have it out in the sun, just walked from here to there. That's how sensitive it is. And there's a group in this country. And they have a camp. And their kids go to camp and they sleep all day and they play all night. And it's really very interesting. So Aziz is a Turk. He was born in Turkey, educated in Turkey. He got his medical degree in Turkey and he came to the University of Texas in Dallas and got his PhD in microbiology. And then he went to Yale, and that's where he learned about DNA repair. Carolina and did all this very, very elegant biochemistry first with the whole bacteria enzymes and then the enzymes. So it's very fun to have DNA repair finally get recognized for the important area that is. We didn't have all our repair enzymes working as we speak. We would be yes.
So as far as I understand it, the way radiation works is it goes and it disrupts base repairs. That's why I don't give it to you. So basically, we don't give it to your mom.
All right. So this is
the answer. My question is not.
Is it part of the immune system? And why does it cancer happen?
Wait, okay, so first radiation. So 95% of the damage is produced by ions and radiation. While base damage is single strand breaks, just bases thrown off. Then there's a small percentage of double strand breaks. And that's repaired by a different system. It wasn't your knowledge. Well, it's a much more complicated system because it's a combination. So, but the basics is your repair. So that's how I got started with repair. So it's the basics is your repair system that repairs most ions of radiation. And all of our cells, it's not, if you get inflammation, that's a mutagen, carcinogen, because you start making all these free radicals, which damage DNA, which are no good. But each of our cells has these repair systems. They have the three that I just talked about. It just happened. And the enzymes that look go up and down, this is what we're working on now, we actually can see in real time. The first enzymes in the pathway go up and down DNA. We know how they search for damage. We've done a lot of molecular and single molecule studies to do this. Watch them in real time. And we all have these enzymes. They're housekeeping enzymes. They're searching up and down DNA to remove damages. Oh, cancer has them. Oh, yeah. So what they're doing now in personalized medicine, and this is the novel. So you go in and you have a tumor, okay? They sequence the DNA in your tumor, and so they know what enzymes are expressed and what are not expressed. Sometimes the repair enzymes are overexpressed, and in fact, if they treat you with something that's repaired by those enzymes, oh, they'll get more and more expressed, and the tumor will become resistant. And what they're doing now is they're going in, they sequence the tumor the first time, they give you the drugs, okay? And they go in and sequence it again and see what enzymes are now overexpressed or mutated or whatever, and they can design treatments to now treat tumor the second time. And they're going through and doing this, and you know, it's still in a very experimental state. And I've known some really unbelievable results of people at the illness in the final. You know, it's where it's going, personalized medicine, and DNA repair, especially again, it's very involved in neurological. Well, because as you can imagine, we don't replicate our DNA. We have to be really efficient mechanisms to repair it. Great cells are not there if we haven't destroyed the vial of wine.
Was there a question from a student?
So if my understanding is correct, you have these enzymes that the tumor itself, you've got these working enzymes that are, you know, with the DNA replication on faulty DNA or on DNA that has been pre-damaged, they are immune. So do you think that in the future there could be a way to like redirect those and have them repair in the correct way?
Well, I think what will happen with cancer is they'll figure out how to kill the ones that they can kill, and you know, anything can be done with genetic engineering, but
other questions for Susan? I think I have one. We'll stop after that one. You know, so I thought you know, you talk about different risk factors in cancer disease and then related to DNA, and you will correct me, but I thought one of the strongest risk factors for cancer. Just because the more your cells replicate, the more chances there are for error.
That's exactly true. It's accumulation damage.
Right. So then this is related to these DNA repair mechanisms, because it seems like, okay, so the more cells replicate, the more chances there are for errors, but then those errors should be caught by these kinds of replication correction mechanisms. So then, is there a change in, say, the level of expression of these repair enzymes over time, or am I not perceiving it?
No, you're exactly right. People have looked at that. And some studies say they go up, other studies they say they go down. It's a little bit black box, but you have to remember that all cancers are these starting probably 80 to 95% of cancers starting with DNA damage. Okay? So the first thing happens, you have to damage. Well, fortunately, we have all these great repair systems that repair the damage. But on the other hand, statistically, one might not be repaired. Maybe it's not an important part of the genome, not much of our genome does very much. But it may not be an important part of the genome, but even if it is, then it replicates. Some cancers, like colon cancers, take 10 years to develop. That's why colonoscopies are so wonderful. We're like almost 100% prevented. But you have an immunological mutation, is in something that's going to cause a change in something on the cell surface, then your immune system comes in and gets rid of those. So I think if you really think about it, you're constantly getting cancers all the time. And the fact that you're getting older, it's more likely to come out, it's just statistical. You know? You've just accumulated, this one damage is the bad gene, and that's it. You may have a lot of other damages, but by this time,